You know, not every Easter Bunny is also Wolverine.
I'm dealing with perishables, right? You've got all year to prepare.
Why are rabbits always so nervous?
And why are you always such a blowhard?
Is that all in one house?
No. Can't you see we're trying to argue?
Sorry, not all of us get to work one night a year. Am I right, Sandy?
Born in Sydney, New South Wales, Australia in 1968, Hugh Jackman was the son of an English accountant. While attending school, he appeared in school productions, but dreamed of traveling the world and having a career as an airplane chef. After spending a year as a PE teacher, he enrolled at the University of Technology, Sydney, where he graduated with a BA in communications. It was during his final year at university that he had an experience that changed his direction in life. In order to make up missing credits, he took a drama course and, during the class, he played the lead in a production of Vaclav Havel's The Memorandum. In an interview with Daily Extra, he said, "In that week, I felt more at home with those people than I did in the entire 3 years." He followed up his university education by enrolling in The Journey at the Actors Center in Sydney. The one-year program of intensive acting training marked the moment that Jackman became serious about thinking of acting as a career. He graduated with a job offer for Australian soap Neighbours, but turned it down to attend the Western Australian Academy of Performing Arts in Perth. Once again, an offer was waiting for him as soon as he graduated, and this time he accepted a role on the 10-part drama series Corelli. What followed was a skyrocketing career on the stage, including playing Gaston in the Australian company of Beauty and the Beast, and an Olivier-nominated turn as Curly in Oklahoma for the Royal National Theatre. But his major breakthrough and the role that has followed him ever since was in 2000, when he appeared as Wolverine in X-Men. He was recommended by fellow Aussie Russell Crowe, who had originally been attached to the role. Jackman prepared for the role by studying tough man movies like the Dirty Harry and Mad Max series, while also studying martial arts and analyzing videos of boxing matches, particularly the early matches of Mike Tyson. The preparation paid off as Jackman would win a Saturn Award for Best Actor. While he has built a career taking on very different roles and starring on Broadway and even starting his own production company, Jackman has frequently returned to the role of Wolverine. With his role in 2017's Logan, Jackman became officially recognized by the Guinness Book of World Records as the actor with the longest career as a live-action Marvel superhero. In 2019, he toured the world performing songs from The Greatest Showman live, and he was planned to star in a revival of The Music Man on Broadway, which would have happened in September of 2020 if other things had also not happened that put a lot of Broadway productions on ice.
You want to paint some eggs? Yeah?
Okay.
Come on, then.
Rimsky-Korsakov. That's a lot of eggs.
How much time do we have?
We've discussed the rise of the Guardians in a previous video for the Santa Advent calendar. But for those of you who haven't watched that, first of all, there should be a link appearing to go check it out in one of these corners up here. I think I did pretty good work. But second, let me give you a quick catch-up. 2012's Rise of the Guardians was a DreamWorks adventure comedy in CGI where the legends of childhood are portrayed as badass butt-kickers who defend children from the darker forces in the world. It was directed by Peter Ramsey, who went on to direct Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and written by Fuddy Mears playwright David Lindsay Abaire, based on the series of books by William Joyce, who based those books on bedtime stories he used to tell his daughter. The movie updated the setting of the books to the modern day, and tells the story of Jack Frost, voiced by the modern-day Captain James T. Kirk, Chris Pine, being initiated into the Guardians just in time to face the evil of Pitch. It was the last CGI film produced by DreamWorks under its original contract with Paramount Pictures before they moved under the umbrella of 20th Century Fox. It was made on a budget of $145 million and grossed $103 million domestically, and yes, it is criminally underrated, and if you haven't watched it, you should correct that right now.
That's the Easter Bunny?
Now somebody sees me. I mean, where were you about an hour ago, mate?
What happened to him? He used to be huge and cool, and now he's cute.
He's good.
Ah. Did you tell him to say that? That's it. Let's go. Me and you. Come on.
Hugh Jackman's Bunny is completely in line with the rest of the Guardians. He's an innocent scion of childhood, depicted as a badass butt-kicker. In this case, they leverage Jackman's strong native Aussie voice to turn the Easter Bunny into Bunnymund, or just Bunny, a boomerang-bearing jackrabbit you don't want to mess with. But the real success of Rise of the Guardians is that it's not just that simple. The Guardians are specifically there as defenders of joy and innocence, and as such they have their own reasons for doing what they do. For Bunnymund, there is a sheer joy of life. Jackman's Bunnymund isn't a warrior, he's a defender. He's there to enjoy life and share that joy with everyone else, but he's not afraid to fight to protect it. Fun thing, Bunnymund refers to Easter as being about springtime, which, yeah, that's a lot of what Easter means to people, but Hugh Jackman and the character of Bunnymund are from Australia. Easter is an autumnal holiday in Australia, just fun to note. What do you think of Rise of the Guardians and the Bunnymund? Jump into the comments below and let me know, and while you're there, click like and subscribe and ring the bell to be notified when new videos get posted. And if you really liked this video, share it with a friend. Until next time, watch like it means something.